Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present First Family, George Washington's Heirs and the Making of America by Cassandra A. Good. Read by Courtney Patterson. A note before we begin. For a family tree, notes on the text, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/first family. Note on terminology. In this book, I use first names for the members of the Washington and Custis families and last names for others with whom they interacted. Note that Elizabeth Park Custis went by Betsy as a young woman, but Eliza after her marriage in 1796. When discussing slavery, I have chosen my wording according to still-evolving standards in the historical profession at the time of publication. Rather than owners or masters, I use the term enslavers, and rather than slaves, enslaved people. This shift in language recognizes the humanity of individuals held in bondage and the inability of any one person to truly own another. To avoid repetition, I occasionally use the term bondspeople in lieu of enslaved people. There are two terms for which historians are still debating the best substitutes: runaway/running away and plantation. For the former, I describe enslaved people who fled bondage as having freed themselves. While some scholars currently use the phrase self-emancipated, this term may obscure reality because it implies a legal process of emancipation. Finally, while I recognize the unduly positive connotations of plantation, I find the current substitutes, slave labor camp or forced labor camp, problematic in myriad other ways. Therefore, I have used plantation in this book, and I believe it will be clear to readers that these were not the romantic places of popular imagination. Prologue. On a cold day in New York City in the winter of 1789, a family prepared to sit for their portrait. This was no ordinary family. It was President George Washington's. They were America's very first family. They stood frozen in their poses before the artist in a rented house with luxurious mahogany furniture, rich carpets, and newly painted walls. Through the windows, they could watch white-sailed ships make their way down the East River. In the finished painting, it is the Potomac River that curves gently through the background. In the forefront, George and Martha sit across from each other at a table with a map of the new District of Columbia unfurled. George rests his arm on the shoulder of a young boy in a coral suit standing at his side, while a girl in a white gown stands behind the table and next to Martha. Visible in the shadows of the painting, an enslaved man stands behind the white family. When the portrait was finally completed nearly a decade later, the artist, Edward Savage, reproduced the Washington family in thousands of prints that made their way into homes across the country. In the late 18th and 19th centuries, everyone in the new United States would have recognized these children. But as far as most Americans in the 21st century know, George Washington never had any children. Some may have read the words of George Washington's most famous eulogist: "Americans, he had no child but you, and he was all your own." Who, then, are these children? Who was Washington's family? It was a question I started asking over a decade ago when I first came across Washington family members in historic records. Clearly, I thought, what I needed was a family tree. As it turned out, this was no simple task. There were no comprehensive family trees online. With further digging, I located a Washington descendant who had compiled just what I was looking for: a massive family tree that showed all the descendants of George Washington's father. It arrived in the mail in a tall poster tube, and the document I opened stretched 5 feet long and 2 feet wide. The tree mapped out 10 children by 2 wives, 40 grandchildren, 130 great-grandchildren, and around 300 great-great-grandchildren. Sprawled out on the floor, I leaned down over the long document to read through the names. The children from the family portrait, who I had learned were Eleanor, Nellie, and George Washington, Wash, Park Custis, weren't there. The Custis children's names were absent for good reason. They were not blood related to George Washington at all. They would only appear on a separate family tree for the Custis family, into which their grandmother and future First Lady, Martha, had first married. Martha Dandridge had entered one of Virginia's wealthiest families when she wed Daniel Park Custis in 1750. The pair had four children, but only the two youngest, John Jackie Park Custis and Martha Patsy Park Custis, survived past toddlerhood. When Daniel died suddenly in 1757, Martha became the wealthiest widow in the colony, a prime catch for a young man on the make like George Washington. George and Martha married in 1759, when George was almost 27 and Martha nearly 28. George's marriage to Martha propelled him into Virginia's upper gentry, bringing his wife, her children, some of the 84 enslaved people she inherited, and her wealth to Mount Vernon. George expanded the house, inherited from his brother Lawrence, who died young, and profited off the labor of bondspeople to make his estate productive. Martha maintained her role as the primary parent, with the often absent George as a stern but loving stepfather to Jackie and Patsy Custis. Jackie was, his stepfather said, a boy of good genius, but he was a lazy student who George lamented was more interested in dogs, horses, and guns than learning. Jackie dropped out of one school after another. His sister Patsy had to stay close to home because she suffered from seizures, which her parents did everything they could to treat. Nonetheless, their sweet, innocent girl, as George called her, died after a fit in 1773 at only 17. Soon after, Jackie married, against his stepfather's advice, who felt the 20-year-old Jackie was too immature and irresponsible, a young Maryland woman named Eleanor Calvert. Eleanor and Jackie had seven children, four of whom survived, before Jackie died suddenly in 1781. Elizabeth, Eliza, Martha, Patty, Nellie, and Wash Park Custis, then, were in today's parlance, George Washington's step-grandchildren. While Americans in the 18th and early 19th centuries did not use the language of step-families, such blended families were quite common due to high death and remarriage rates. With four children aged five or under on her hands, Eleanor Calvert Custis might well have been overwhelmed. Martha, missing having children in the house, offered to take Nellie and Wash and raise them at Mount Vernon with George. This would not have been unusual at the time, and Eleanor and her elder daughters lived close by and visited regularly. There was as of yet no legal form of adoption, but people referred to Nellie and Wash as George's adopted children. Nonetheless, this was also a time when blood relationships were central to legal definitions of family and inheritance. Thus, George Washington could essentially adopt two children and raise them as his own, but have no children. Indeed, while never having any biological children of their own, George and Martha raised and supported other children beyond the Custis grandchildren. They took in a bevy of nieces and nephews over the course of their decades together. Both George and Martha had numerous siblings and, in George's case, half-siblings. A rotating cast of orphaned nieces and nephews, or those whose parents had too many children at home to support, made temporary homes with the Washingtons. Others received considerable financial support and advice. It was Bushrod Washington, the eldest son of George's late eldest full brother, who inherited the famous Washington estate of Mount Vernon. Is Edward Savage's family portrait really the Washington family, then? It turned out that the answer to my question, who was George Washington's family, was far more complicated than I imagined. Over more than a decade, I have searched through images, objects, houses, financial records, letters, and diaries scattered over museums and archives from Boston to New Orleans. I read 19th century newspaper and magazine articles, spoke to living descendants, and conferred with archivists and fellow historians. I spent months researching at Mount Vernon, working through papers in its library vault, and talking with curators and librarians there. As the pieces fell into place, I found that there was no single definition of George Washington's family or who counted as his descendants. But one thing was clear. For Americans, from the Revolution to the Civil War, the Custis grandchildren were George Washington's family. This was no accident. It was the result of choices that George, Martha, the Custises, and the Washington nieces and nephews all made. While George supported many of his nephews and nieces, his closest emotional bonds were with Martha's grandchildren. They, especially Nellie and Wash, spent the most time living with him, hearing his stories, and experiencing life as the nation's first family. Martha prioritized keeping the family together, bringing the children with them as the capital city moved from New York to Philadelphia. The public visibility all four siblings gained during the presidency cemented their role as George's family early on in their lives. None of George's blood-related family members ever had this kind of close access and public recognition. After George Washington's death, the Custises and the Washington nieces and nephews continued on diverging paths. While a Washington nephew inherited Mount Vernon, the house was an empty shell when he moved in. All the Washington furniture, china, clothing, and other household objects that quickly attained the status of relics ended up in the Custis grandchildren's hands. The grandchildren, then, had both the family stories and belongings that could keep George's memory and legacy alive. They chose to use those strategically at every step, while the Washington nieces and nephews lived largely in obscurity as small Virginia planters. When Bushrod Washington, inheritor of Mount Vernon, died in 1829, his obituary did not even mention his relationship to his famous uncle. His nephew and grandnephew, who next owned Mount Vernon, John Augustine Washington II and III, similarly preferred to stay out of the limelight. It was the Custis grandchildren, then, who took center stage as George Washington's family. They nurtured their celebrity as the first family, contributing to political discussions, inviting visitors to their homes to share stories and display relics, and serving as representatives of George Washington's revolutionary legacy at social and political events. None of them had any particular talents or accomplishments in their own right. Their fame came from who they were and how they shaped their public personas, not what they had done. It is hard to overstate just how famous George Washington was in the late 18th century. One writer has called him America's first celebrity-in-chief. The Custises simply needed to grasp onto and perpetuate that celebrity by presenting themselves as his surrogates and keepers of his legacy. It didn't hurt Nellie and Wash that the Savage family portrait remained ubiquitous in America until the Civil War, copied by young women in needlework and printed as lithographs in versions that subtly changed with the times. Many Americans had some version of this image in their homes, and those who did not surely recognized it. Interestingly, the shadowy figure of the enslaved man in the background of the painting disappeared from several versions of the image in the antebellum era. Americans preferred not to see the first president as an enslaver. Bonds people had not disappeared from the Custis' lives, however. Most of the enslaved at Mount Vernon had been owned by the Custis estate, not George Washington himself, and they remained in bondage to the Custises after George and Martha died. All four grandchildren lived with and depended upon enslaved people and their children who had come from Mount Vernon, although few records of these bonds people survive. The Custises also had black relatives born into slavery through the sexual violation of enslaved women. The latest research points to the probability that their father, Jackie, had a son, William Costin, with an enslaved woman, and Wash Custis had numerous children with bondswomen as well. While Costin and several of Wash's mixed-race children gained their freedom, the Custises excluded them all from the siblings' quest to remain known as George Washington's family. In that sense, they were truly erased. The fact that Americans today know little to nothing about the white members of the Custis family is not an act of deliberate erasure, but rather a subtler process of forgetting. Who were these celebrated siblings, and how did they handle being the first family? How would they use the fame and power that came from their ties to George Washington? How could they live up to the revolutionary legacy? What did it mean to be part of a political family in a democracy, particularly for women? This book reveals the forgotten story of a family that Americans 200 years ago knew quite well. Eliza, Patty, Nellie, and Wash Custis. It is a story of four proud but profoundly flawed people that has much to reveal about how we understand both our country and our families. Chapter 1.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.